UTM basis. Hepatitis and liver transplant and physician for past 18 years. Involved since beginning of liver transplant in South India 2008 onwards and experience of 1000 plus liver transplants. Teaching faculty of DNB program at Hyderabad University. Research intervention, liver transplant, liver failure management and fatty disease. With this I welcome Dr. N. Murugan. Please come.
Thank you, sir. I am actually a member of IMA PHO. I am very happy to interact with you today. So I talked about a common problem, fatty liver disease. Almost all of you will see fatty liver in your practice. But I want to highlight some important aspects of fatty liver disease because it may not be known to non-liver specialists or non-gastro specialists. Since we deal with sick patients with liver disease, we see a lot of patients come with cirrhosis for meat transplant and liver cancer purely due to fatty liver disease. And when we tell them that this is due to fatty liver disease, they are in a shock. They said, but I have this for 20 years. They said, there's nothing wrong. Now you're saying it because of this. So the other end of the spectrum is very frightening. A lot of women come with fatty liver disease. So it affects them 40s, 50s and 60s. And some of the issues I will discuss with you today. So as always, we want to prevent progression to end-stage liver disease. And that is the best way to treat a patient rather than find out they have liver failure and then recommend transplant. And sometimes liver cancer as well. So it can be a problem. So the term NAFLD has been used for many years because it is a fatty liver disease without alcohol. This again, sometimes even patients and sometimes even doctors think liver cirrhosis means patient is drinking alcohol. Only about 30-40% of patients we see with cirrhosis is due to alcohol. The remaining 60-70% may be due to other causes. So alcohol is a part of cirrhosis but not the only cause. So this term was derived as a non-alcoholic fatty liver disease because the clinical histological features are very similar to alcoholic liver disease but without alcohol. But a better way to describe it will be metabolic liver disease, which is currently under proposal and maybe soon the terminology may change. But for now we call it NAFLD. And when there's more than 5% or 10% fat in the liver, which is mainly triglyceride, then we call it as fatty liver. And this is histological or radiological. So fatty liver disease can be divided into four groups. One is NAFL, non-alcoholic fatty liver, which is a simple steatosis without inflammation or injury in the liver. It's a very important aspect for us because this differentiates a patient who will do well from somebody with serious problems. So this group is okay. But once you come down to this group, the beginning of which is a term called NASH, some of you may have heard of it. It means non-alcoholic steatohepatitis. There is an inflammation. So when you do biopsy on them, there will be inflammation and a significant injury called ballooning, where the cells start getting swollen and they start dying. That is a very serious problem because it triggers a cascade of problems that is ongoing and leads to cell death, cirrhosis, cancer and so on. So NASH is the starting point. NASH will lead to NASH fibrosis. There are four grades of fibrosis, starting from 1 to 4, and 4 is generally considered as cirrhosis. And then we have NASH-related cirrhosis with the typical nodular features. And interestingly, once the fibrosis and the nodularity comes, the fat starts disappearing. So even on imaging, you may not see fat. And if you biopsy also, you may not see fat. It will just be filled with fibrosis. So these are the different stages of fatty liver disease that we see. What concerns us as doctors and liver specialists is this stage where patients can progress very quickly to cirrhosis and end-stage liver disease. It's a very common problem. About 30% of our population have fatty liver disease. There was a beautiful study done by Dr. Mohan from Chennai on the Chennai Urban Epidemiological Study. And he found around 32% of urban population will have fatty liver disease, which is similar in many other studies in India and abroad, between 30-35%, depending on the population. There is a slight less occurrence in the rural area, mainly due to nutrition and body habitus. but in urban areas it is slightly higher. So it is a common problem. 30% of the population is a huge number. It's a very common problem. But when you have a risk factor, the number is significantly higher. This is the important thing I wanted to pick up today. If you have obesity, the incidence of fatty liver can go up to 90%. If you have diabetes or even glucose intolerance or IFG, even up to 70% of diabetics can have fatty liver. And if you have dyslipidemia, up to 50%. There is this term we use called metabolic syndrome, which is a very important aspect of fatty liver disease and even in cardiovascular disease. And if you have fatty liver, around 90% of these patients will have one feature of metabolic syndrome, and about one third will have all the features. And on the opposite side, if you have metabolic syndrome, the risk of fatty liver significantly increases. So there is an interplay between all these conditions. And as you know, diabetes is so common in India, and a lot of them will have fatty liver disease, and they are higher risk for liver damage. So typically, obesity, type 2 diabetes, dyslipidemia, metabolic syndrome, they are all strongly associated with the development of fatty liver disease. There are other associations which have been recently picked up, polycystic ovary syndrome, for example, thyroid disease, obstructive sleep apnea. So they all have links to fatty liver disease, probably through shared associations like obesity. So metabolic syndrome becomes an important aspect of understanding fatty liver disease. This is the most widely used criteria, WHO criteria. And central obesity plays a key part because all of us have the central obesity, particularly South Asians. And this leads to insulin resistance, cardiac disease, fatty liver disease, and so on. So you have a high waist circumference, blood pressure, either diabetes or even elevated fasting glucose, increased triglycerides, long HDL. So this is the components of metabolic syndrome. If you have 3 out of 5, it is considered metabolic syndrome. And central obesity is a key aspect of this component. There are some secondary causes of hepatic steatosis. So when you are dealing with fatty liver, you should always keep this in mind. They are not common, so you don't rarely come across them. Of course, alcohol has to be ruled out, hepatitis C, Wilson's disease, patients on parenteral nutrition, certain medications. And these are rare causes, acute fatty liver of pregnancy, Rett syndrome, etc. So always you have an idea that it may be a secondary cause, rule it out, and then if they have metabolic disease, then you treat it differently. So why is fatty liver disease important? And there are some beautiful population-based studies from Europe and US which have highlighted the importance in terms of patient outcomes and mortality. Here is a US study where they showed if you have basically simple steatosis, the risk of death either from liver or cardiac is similar to the general population. But if you isolate patients with NASH, there is a significant increase in liver death, but more interestingly, much more increase in cardiac death. So more than liver-related complication and death, fatty liver disease is associated with cardiac death much more often. And it is considered a more important cause of death than liver disease. But this happened only in patients who develop NASH and other complications. And again, this is a population-based study from the US which showed that if you have fatty liver disease, your risk of dying is more than the general population. And when you separate them into simple steatosis and NASH, the simple steatosis and general population, similar outcomes. But NASH patients over a 20-year period have more death than the general population. So there seems to be two aspects to the fatty liver disease, simple steatosis and NASH. We believe, say even 5 to 10 years back, that if you either have one or the other, you cannot have both. But now we know that you can progress from one to the other. As your risk profile changes, maybe you get older, you develop metabolic syndrome. So you may have had simple steatosis when you were 30, 35. But by then you are 50, your stress factors are high, and you may progress to NASH and cirrhosis. So that distinction is now becoming more clear to us with the research we are doing. So luckily, among patients with fatty liver disease, only about 20 to 25% with the associated risk factors will develop NASH. So this is where there is a confusion in practice when you see a patient with fatty liver. At the one hand, you don't want to tell every patient with fatty liver, you're going to get cirrhosis, you're going to get liver cancer. But same time, we don't want to tell them, you know, it's only 5 kilometers of money. So you need to identify who are at risk, how to monitor them, and give them a counseling that at some stage they may develop complications. So keep monitoring, keep working on your stress factors. This group who developed NASH, around 5% may develop cirrhosis, and like I mentioned, liver cancer is a big problem in patients with fatty liver disease. And there are many papers and studies to show that NASH is a multi-system disease, and we can even call it as an extra component of the metabolic syndrome, because it is not an isolated disease. There are links with diabetes, cardiac disease, kidney disease, bone disease, and so on. The association not only is there for fatty liver disease, but those with metabolic syndrome, diabetes, hypertension, obesity have an increased risk of developing NASH and progressing to cirrhosis. And there is a genetic basis also. The PNPLA3 gene has been associated, a variant of that gene or a mutation has been associated with an increased progression to cirrhosis and HCC. But the link is very strong, not very strong, because you can't just do a genetic marker and then predict, okay, you will develop NASH, you won't develop NASH. But there are some genetic basis to it, but we are not able to use that currently to guide therapy or to assess risk in a strong way. But we will have to wait and see if further analysis reveals any strong association. But it's just interesting to know that there is a genetic basis to who develops NASH and who doesn't develop NASH. So this is a background about how fatty liver disease can lead to mortality in some patients, and how to assess these patients, how do we follow them up, what kind of treatment we can offer them. So ultrasound is the simplest way to assess fat, and I don't know if any radiologists are here, they will tell you better, but there are basically three ways to grade fatty liver on ultrasound. Grading is important, but not the only component of disease. Again, this is a common myth or mistake or assumption among patients and maybe some doctors too, that if it's grade 1, patient will be alright, grade 2, grade 3, it's more serious. Of course, the amount of fat does matter, but it's not the only aspect of assessing the risk for NASH and cirrhosis. And like I mentioned, the higher the damage, less the fat. So you may have grade 1 or no fat, but patient may have cirrhosis. So it's a guide, but you can't use only ultrasound to decide somebody's sick or not. It's just to pick up fatty liver. There are more advanced techniques to pick up fat in the liver. One of them is the FibroScan gap value, which we are using in our hospital, where you can get a quantitative assessment of fat along with fibrosis, and then there are grading according to the value that you see and the percentage of fat that you can expect. It is not 100% accurate like a biopsy, but being simple, non-invasive, like an ultrasound, it gives you an idea. It's about 85-90% accurate. MRI is much more advanced than FibroScan gap and gives you a better value and gives you a more better percentage. Again, it is expensive, but we do use it in the context of living donors for liver transplant, where the precise amount of fat has to be known before you subject the patient for a donor surgery. So in those situations we use MR spectroscopy, and it will give you an exact percentage of fat in this. This probably is the best non-invasive modality to estimate fat. But in practice, ultrasound is good enough. It gives you an idea, and you can use a grading to decide how much of fat, and then see whether further investigation is required. ALT is probably not very reliable to assess the risk of the patient or the severity of the liver disease, because you can see here these are different stages of the patient: no fibrosis, mild fibrosis, bridging fibrosis, cirrhosis. ALT is all over the place. So using ALT, you cannot decide the histological stage of the patient. So you can have a normal ALT in cirrhosis, you can have ALT 100 with no cirrhosis, so the correlation is very poor. Generally speaking, if somebody has fatty liver on ultrasound, ALT is more than 1.5 or 2 times elevated, like 60 or 80, there is something going on in the liver. But if they have fatty liver on ultrasound, ALT is 25-30, the chances are they are okay, but if they have other risk factors, you may want to do further assessment. So it is a guide in general practice or day-to-day practice to decide whether somebody has problem. we say ALT up to 280 or 250 to 80, usually it is around 100 to 150, that is the range you see, and they have rash between 2 to 5 times, but sometimes we see more than 200 and it can be again due to rash. So the ALT value is very high in the context of fatty liver, there is no other cause contributing to that, and very likely the patient has rash and may have some fibrosis also. So it is a guide. What is more important in assessing fatty liver is to assess the fibrosis component, because that is the one that causes serious complications, mortality, etc. Traditionally we rely on liver biopsy, but in practice it is impractical. You cannot, one third of the population you can't go around biopsying them. So we need a better way to assess fibrosis, and now with the advanced imaging and other technology, we are getting non-invasive assessment of fibrosis. You can use blood markers, there are some scores based on blood markers of fibrosis, or you can use imaging modalities to assess fibrosis. So the simple online calculator called NAFLD fibrosis score uses a combination of features: age, BMI, presence of diabetes, AST, ALT, platelet, everything. So simple way to kind of get idea there can be fibrosis. This is around 80% accurate, you can say, around 20% error rate. So it's a good way to screen patients. So this is what we try to do in my hospital, and we have a specialized fatty liver clinic. So the patient comes with fatty liver, we put through the score. If the score is low, then we can be more or less reassured that this patient has a very advanced disease. So ALT is normal. If the score is high, then we pick these patients up and try to do advanced imaging to see if they may have fibrosis. If they have, then we plan treatment and so on. So it's a simple screening tool to find out if your patient is progressing to advanced disease. This ultrasound ALT may not be enough, so you need to put this score. It is available online. A fibrometer is a company-derived score where they use this A2N, which is a fibrosis molecule. It's a bit expensive, it is available in India in one or two labs. So you can use this to get an idea. It may be similar accuracy to NAFLD fibrosis score, maybe 5 to 10% more. This is what we rely on a lot in my hospital for the fibroscan. It's an ultrasound-based assessment of fibrosis. There are other ultrasound-based assessments also, but this is the most widely studied. And it gives you a kind of idea about the fibrosis level based on this. This is the fat level, this is the fibrosis level. So it measures the stiffness of the liver. The higher the stiffness, more the fibrosis. That's how the principle is. This cannot be used like a regular ultrasound machine. It is purely for liver assessment only. It is a pioneer machine from France, and it has been widely used in liver disease in the last 10 years or so. So we have been using this for the last 4 to 5 years. And finally, histology is the best way. We call it imperfect gold standard because even with histology there is some error rate, but it will grade fat, inflammation, fibrosis and cirrhosis in a very accurate way. So very rarely we are using biopsy nowadays because of the practicality, cost, patient acceptance, potential risk of complications and so on. Relying more on the non-invasive imaging techniques. So once you decide somebody has fatty liver, you need a quick way to assess them. So you find out if there are any secondary causes, alcohol, etc. Find out if they have metabolic syndrome, whether ALT is raised or not. If it is raised without significant metabolic disease, look for other causes. If it is raised with metabolic disease, then work up for severity of liver disease. In a similar way, like I told you, you can do some fibrosis assessment. You can do an online score to see if they need to be taken up for other tests. Maybe sometimes you may need a biopsy if you're not sure and so on. So the treatment has, I'll talk first about, I'll come back to that. So the treatment can be predominantly lifestyle modification. We still rely a lot on this. We have to target components of the metabolic syndrome individually and control it, whether it's diabetes, obesity, hypertension and so on, triglycerides. There is liver-directed pharmacotherapy to reduce NASH and perhaps even reduce fibrosis. It can be done. And if they develop cirrhosis and complications, you manage them. So this is the principles of treatment. And the bottom of the pyramid is the largest portion, because that is the most important and the most effective. If you do this, without that, patient is not going to get better. So these are pathophysiology of NASH, which are now targets of therapy. There is insulin resistance, increased inflammatory markers in the liver, free fatty acid cytokines. There is ER stress, oxidative stress, mitochondrial injury. All these are molecular injury from cytokine-related injury, and eventually leads to cell death. In the liver, there is a unique process. Wherever there is inflammation, there is a signaling for stellate cell activation, which immediately starts fibrosis. So whenever there is inflammation, immediately fibrosis will start, and this is how patients end up with cirrhosis. So this pathophysiology is helping to find molecules to alter the pathophysiology at the same time as you change the lifestyle factors. So both go hand in hand. So three simple ways to change the fatty liver or your metabolic stress. Weight reduction if you are overweight, 5 to 10%. Not very difficult. Independently, exercise has shown to reduce metabolic stress. It has shown to reduce the amount of fat. It has shown to reverse NASH, but not fibrosis. So it plays a significant role independent of weight loss, just exercise. And the studies have shown optimal exercise for this purpose at least, and this is used for cardiac and other problems also. It is 150 minutes a week, spread out over 3-4 days or 5 days. There are now studies to show aerobic exercise with resistance strength training is better than aerobic exercise alone. So this is what we recommend if they want targeted therapy. Diet plays a supplementary role. These two are more important than diet, but diet plays a supplementary role. And we generally advise a low calorie diet to reduce weight. Most important is low carbohydrates. This is the most important aspect, not fat. You can take normal amount of fat and moderate to high protein. So the key is the low carbohydrate, particularly the high glycemic index carbohydrate like fructose, sucrose, sugar drinks, etc. The reason why weight loss is important is even a 5% weight loss will reduce ballooning and inflammation in 40% of patients, even up to 100%. A weight loss of 10% can cause fibrosis regression in 45% of patients. So weight loss in patients who are overweight or obese plays a significant role in reversing the inflammatory process, as much as drugs. So this hypocalorie diet with moderate intensity exercise should lead to sustained weight loss. Many times, I'm sure all of you know this, patients will come and say, it's simply not possible. If you reduce your calorie, increase exercise, you have to lose weight. So somewhere there is a problem. So somehow we have to get through the emotion of the patient, make them understand that this is a science. If you do this, you will lose weight and you have to work on that. So coming to drugs, the only approved drugs based on studies, which was published in NEJM many years back, is pioglitazone, which is an anti-diabetic drug, and vitamin E, which is an antioxidant, which reduces the inflammatory drivers within the liver. These two are the only approved drug as of today. There are a lot of supplements available for liver, S-arginine, also deoxycholic acid, metatoxin, and so on, a lot of combinations, LIV-52. None of them are scientifically proven to reverse NASH or fatty liver. But they are available, people are using it. But if you look at scientific evidence, the only pioglitazone, vitamin E, which has shown to reduce inflammation, to some extent reverse fibrosis. The problem is, you use it for 1 year, 2 years, there is some reversal, you stop it, if the patient's body condition, lifestyle doesn't change, it's going to come back again. So that seems to be the problem with pharmacotherapy. So some exciting new developments are coming through in pharmacotherapy, and these are because molecules are identified within the liver and the inflammatory cascade, which drive this inflammatory process and how to modify them. So two molecules have been identified. One is the FXR enzyme molecule, which seems to downregulate all the bad things that are happening in the liver, mainly the inflammation, etc. So if you use an agonist of FXR, which is called obeticholic acid, which is available in the US for a different condition, but not yet approved for NASH, is not available in India as of now. But it is in the phase 2, phase 3, I think entered phase 3, the last stage of studies. And many of the US doctors are saying, probably in a year's time it will be available in US, and soon it may be available in India for exclusive use for NASH patients. This is one option, in the next 1 year we are going to get. Another is the PPAR, again is an enzyme molecule, there are different types of PPAR. And this is one of the drugs that are being developed in the US to again, is an agonist of PPAR, which will reduce all the inflammatory markers in the liver. Saraglitazar is also a PPAR agonist. This is exclusively produced in India by Zydus. And they have done some studies in India, and in US they are just starting the first stage of studies. It is available to use in India, they launched it for diabetes. So sometimes when patients are very sick, we just use it and they are seeing very dramatic results. I've had a patient with an enzyme of 250 plus. He didn't want a biopsy, and within 6 months it has come to 30. So significant improvement with saraglitazar. So it may be a drug of the future once we have enough studies to convince that this is going to help. We can see a dramatic improvement in the liver inflammation. Cenicrovirac is a CCTIP2 antagonist. Again, it reduces the inflammation within the liver. This is a little toxic drug, so we have to wait and see. It's still not yet available in the market. So in the next 1 to 2 years, these are the four drugs that are likely to come to be used exclusively for NASH and NASH fibrosis. So it will be a big boon for us, more than the patients who will benefit from this. And these are some studies of various drugs. Vitamin E, pioglitazone, liraglutide also helps, obeticholic acid, lefibrinol, cenicrovirac. But the number of patients who benefit in terms of NASH resolution are significantly higher than placebo. The best effect has been seen with diabetic surgery, which we'll talk about in a minute. And similarly, fibrosis reversal, a lot of these drugs are better than placebo, and again, the biggest impact is with bariatric surgery. So bariatric surgery has been shown to reverse fibrosis, and the higher grades of fibrosis become lower grades of fibrosis. But we don't recommend bariatric surgery as a treatment for NASH. So it has to be only used for its own indications like obesity with metabolic complications. But if the patient happens to have NASH, they will have improvement. One more thing about bariatric surgery is you need to know. If the patient is already having cirrhosis, especially if they have advanced disease like what we have mentioned, bariatric surgery can actually make them worse. So the sudden weight loss seems to drive up the decompensation. And we have seen patients who post bariatric surgery within 1 year come with liver failure, who need a liver transplant. So it is not recommended for cirrhosis with advanced features, but pre-cirrhotic NASH patients who need bariatric surgery for other indications will benefit if they have enough bariatric surgery. So right now we can't use it as a treatment. But it's interesting to show that compared to all the drugs, that has the maximum impact simply because they lost weight. They lost 30, 40 kg, the metabolic stress came down, so they were immediately improved. So, just 4 or 5 points for you to remember. Fatty liver disease is not always benign. Around 25% may develop NASH over a 10 to 15 year period. So please remember this and try to screen your patients accordingly. Risk factor assessment is very important when you have fatty liver disease. Always remember to look out and screen for cardiac disease if it is required. If you see a high risk patient either because of history like obesity, diabetes, metabolic syndrome, or enzyme elevation, or grade 3 fatty liver, maybe a detailed liver assessment like FibroScan, etc. may be helpful. And treatment, largely we rely on lifestyle changes, which is the most hardest to implement because patients don't lecture. And pharmacotherapy is exciting because some new drugs are going to come which may change the way we treat this disease. So it is a different roads to treat fatty liver disease. You can go by the metabolic therapy route, you can modify environmental factors, or you can give liver dietary therapy. But all the roads lead to the same goal, to keep the patient disease free. Thank you.
What is your experience in liver elastography?
Experience means it's a very good way to assess fibrosis.
Because the fiber scan is costing around 50-20 lakhs.
Okay.
You are doing only for the liver scan.
Correct.
Instead of that, now the machines are coming out with the liver elastography.
Sure. mean, I mentioned it in my slide. There is ultrasound-based elastography. RC is the early one. Now we have real-time elastography, shear-wave elastography. If for general use, I think that is fine. Since we have a level unit, we wanted a dedicated machine. I agree with you. There are studies to show similar results. For us, it is easy. FibroScan is easy because it is more widely studied in different liver diseases like hepatitis B, hepatitis C, alcohol, NASH, post-transplant, etc. And different algorithms are there. And even therapy algorithms, for example, hepatitis B, if FibroScan is 8 and by the load is 2000, we can treat. So a lot of our guidelines are based on FibroScan value. So for very targeted assessment and planned treatment, we are using FibroScan. But I agree, any ultrasound-based elastography is good enough. In fact, MRI elastography is the best. It is much more accurate than all these machines. Again, cost and availability. Even I wanted for a patient who had an AMI of 40 to do MRI elastography. Nobody in Chennai has it. And I found a place in Bombay who is doing it. But yes, it's still gone. Because ultrasound will not work for Hyderabad is there. So MRI is still the best, but they told that even the software costs about 40 lakhs. And the usage will be very less and nobody wants to use it. Even my hospital we are not using. So I agree. Ultrasound based elastography is equally good. So for a general use that is good enough.
Sir,
fatty
liver, what
would increase the grading has to be given by the radiologist. So grade 1, 2, 3. That's right. So if they see increased echogenicity without the periportal diagrammatic changes, they will call grade 1. If there are other changes, they will say grade 2, grade 3. So then the patient has fatty liver. Then like I mentioned, you have to see ALT, any other risk factors, if the patient gave risk for fibrosis, and go on with it. But ultrasound is a screening tool. It basically tells you that patient has fatty liver. Yes, ma'am. I think it is more like an associated feature. I don't think there's a direct correlation. But I think it is due to the shared association, like obesity. So directly it is not causing osteoporosis. Radiologist is here, they're coming up. Orthopedic is here.
Can I answer? That is due to the post-menopausal. Post-menopausal patients will have the osteoporosis and the obesity associated with that. So those patients are having a fatty liver and osteoporosis. In post-menopausal patients, it's been seen as that osteoporosis and the fatty liver.
But here in general, the second
slide
shows osteoporosis.
Okay,
one more question. How much dose of
pioglitazone we take? Pioglitazone, the studies were 30 milligrams per day. The studies for NASH. So either they gave it as a single dose or split dose, 15 BD. So the dose used for studying was 30 milligrams.
And how much of vitamin E?
Vitamin E, 800 milligrams per day. Either split dose or single dose. So this is the dose used in the studies.
Fatty pancreas.
Sir?
Fatty pancreas.
Fatty pancreas, yeah, it is part of generalized obesity. See, the obesity or fat is divided into visceral and non-visceral fat. And the visceral fat is the one that causes insulin resistance. So there are now again machines to assess distribution of fat. So pancreatic fat is just a marker to show that there is a visceral obesity, a visceral fat increased. And it is now being shown, but we don't have refined techniques, that visceral fat is more important than non-visceral fat. So the overall BMI may be 30, but they may not have much of visceral fat. Or in India, we have this concept called lean NASH, was beautifully described by a doctor in Kolkata, where BMI is 21, 22, very thin people, but 20% of them had fatty liver. So there are various theories for that. So they found that many of them have visceral fat. So it seems to be some genetic, biological problem in South Asians, which is making us prone to this visceral fat. If you see the Western people, they'll either be all fat or they'll be very thin. Here, South Asian will be thin but have a paunch or fat around the belly. So it is more racial also, some racial characteristics. So that's why we are much higher incidence of diabetes, cardiac disease, fatty liver compared to Western. Thank you.
May I request Dr. Srinivas Varma to kindly come and present him with the certificate of appreciation.